Exactly.
Make
sure you can hear me. Simon said, hi everybody, my name is Dave Hayward from Councilmember Bizar's office. Thank you so much for coming tonight. First question, did anyone come to the first meeting? Raise your hand if you came to the first meeting. Alright, so for those of you who aren't aware, this project, as I'm sure you've seen, is the Soto Mission Huntington Drive intersection improvement project, right? Where they're removing the existing bridge and adding two signalized intersections to allow for safer pedestrian and vehicular traffic. As I'm sure many of you know, it's really dangerous going around there. But part of the project the city wanted to do, the Bureau of Engineering really wanted to do, is how do we involve the community in the aesthetic delivery of what it looks like at the end of the project, right? So the Bureau of Engineering partnered with our office and brought on Northeast Trees here, who facilitated the first meeting. I'll be turning it over to them in just a second. But essentially, this is an opportunity for you as a community to figure out, when you drive by there or walk by there or take the bus, what do you want to see in 20 years? What do you want it to look like? How do you want it to represent the community? And how do you want to feel that sense of attachment? So these workshops are an opportunity for you all to give your input, to provide direction, and you're working with some of the best in the business. Northeast Trees is going to ask Scott Dills, they've done a bunch of other things. So if there's not any questions, I'm going to turn it over to Northeast Trees.
Thank you all for coming out. Once again, we are Northeast Trees. My name is Aaron Thomas, and I'm the Urban Forestry Manager with Northeast Trees. This is my colleague and architect and designer for Northeast Trees, Holly Harper. And I'm going to start out by just talking to you a little bit about the history of our organization in this part of the city, and then I'll turn it over to Holly to discuss some of the design that we've come up with for this new streetscape project. Northeast Trees is a nonprofit organization. We've been working in Northeast LA, that's the name, Northeast Trees, for over 25 years. During that time, we have planted somewhere in the environment of 75,000 to 100,000 trees. We've designed and built in-house dozens of parks, beans, streetscapes, and we do also specialize in the community outreach component, so we work closely with the community where we both live and have worked for over 20 years. And the entire staff of our organization is from this part of the city. We specialize in community outreach, and part of that is the youth training component. So we hire young people. Right now we have about 20 youth on our crew from Northeast LA working with us on various projects. But it just so happens that many of our projects are within like a half a mile of where we're all sitting. Just recently, if you just walk half a block up, you'll see the slope of the Rosedale part of Debs Park up above the native garden. We've planted over 200 trees. And the youth that are working with us helped do that. And they also installed irrigation for the entire 200 tree planting. And this is all done over the past three months. In addition to that, we're working at Ascot Hills Park. We planted 500 trees recently in Ascot Hills Park with these youth crews and irrigated all of them. And we have funding to continue doing more of that. So and then Soto Street, we were funded those two projects. In Soto Street, we have a green belt, which all were funded through county Prop 8 funds. We have a green belt so that we're providing more shade and beautification along that slope, along Soto, pretty much between Huntington Drive, and we're going as far south on Soto as we can. Once again, these are all just recent projects, and it just tied in really well when Council District 14 approached us and said, hey, we're working on this bridge project, and since you guys are doing so many projects right here, can you guys help out with the streetscape component? We were happy to do so. Holly, as she'll tell you in a minute, has been literally studying this part of Soto for over 20 years. conceptualizing it as a student in architecture school, and so we're very excited to work with all of you on this project. It's a unique part of the city, it's a unique opportunity. There's a natural landscape here that has so much potential, and we know that over the years, because we've driven through here and walked through here many times, unfortunately over the years it's been neglected, it's been blighted in some situations, but we have now an opportunity to really restore it, to bring it back, and to make it something that the community is proud of, a place where it could be a destination, bringing together of those three major neighborhoods that are joined here, namely, Royal Heights, El Sereno, Rose Hills, Lincoln Heights. So that's kind of the background. We have many years of expertise. We're going to show you guys some photos of previous projects that we worked on that are similar to this situation here on Soto. And Holly's going to talk to you about the process moving forward with how we move from working with you all, getting your input, your ideas, taking into account your concerns, turning that into a design that the city can work with, and then implementation. So Holly's going to discuss those steps with you, and we really want you to see somehow, we've done this for so many years successfully, we want to show you some of our success stories as well. Yes. I think it's the sun.
I'm really happy to be here. As Aaron mentioned, we're passionate about this community, and especially about this particular piece of the landscape of the city. You know, generations ago, hundreds of years ago, thousands of years ago, 10,000 of years ago, this particular piece of the hunt and snakes out of hills was obviously a little path of water came out of the hills and made on its way down into the rest of the city. And we've taken that as inspiration for the landscape and a little bit of the process. We came up here last month before in June, and we were just beginning. We just heard about the project. We had a lot of good feedback from people everywhere. So we think we're going to point those things out for those things. But our purpose here tonight, and we just start to say that the inspiration is this kind of little dry creek bed that snaked out of the hills as our peak of the landscape. This step tonight is about sharing with you some of our first sketches, sharing with you some of our choices of plants, and then all of those that Aaron mentioned, between us, we have over 30 years of experience in really doing not sustainable landscapes. Landscapes that can sustain themselves and establish with minimal upkeep and surviving and thriving on the amount of water we get every day. I think everybody can relate to that, just how important that is. And last time, I apologize, I came, I had no idea how small a tree was going to be, how big the room, so at least I came a little bit later this time. I want to show what I think is one of our projects. Just at the end of Figueroa, we go over to Figueroa to Riverside Drive, that I think is a really important precedent for this medium. It's about the same size and scale, more or less an acre. It's right next to a busy Riverside Drive, freeway on ramps and off ramps. And this is an unpromising state was in 1999. And then when we first installed the project, about 2000, we'll come back to this. This is there's some work that's sparked by an artist collective of both of the local here. We'll talk about that more later. And then these are the slides that show that no one can see. This is where it is today, essentially. Last month before last. The trees are grown in. In our case, in particular, I believe we won't have so much bushy, large material for several reasons. And one is, as much as we want to do, make a very attractive, green, pleasant space to relax and pass through, just never forget that this is a traffic medium. This next to a very dizzy, Lincoln Drive, and everything has to be about maintaining visibility, maintaining sight lines for people, merging in and out of something a little simpler. sessions than it has been in the past. But it will still be something that really constrains our design. But I think you can see that from a very unpromising beginning, 15 years later, you have a shade in this much other place to be.
Creek bed with boulders and sycamores and other things that
next to streams, including the wild roses, and then slope back up again, and have space for trees, and while there'll be a concrete plaza, there'll be a soft surface, close granite walking path to go to travel to concrete, but you can also have an alternative to travel along the right speed though. And this will be several things. I mean, one, I mentioned we're trying to kind of just evoke this idea of what the landscape might have been on time, but it'll do two things. By sort of sloping it gently down, you get a little bit of sense of a separation from the Huntington Drive. And this is only like a foot and a half, and that just a little bit will give you a sense of not being quite such a busy traffic environment. And then a couple particular concerns. For safety, we really recommend that not fencing this off. And there's several reasons for that. And taking that fence budget, because it will look pretty cheap, but it's not cheap in monetary costs, and rolling that into the arts program. And there's several reasons for that. One is just the idea of safety in public space. You know, one idea of safety in public space is what I mentioned, not just for traffic sidelines, but just so that people can always have eyes into the interior. So everything stays low or is a high canopy tree. And you also don't want to, the more you can keep that open to circulation, it's very different from trying to keep your own patch of front yard safe. There you want to put the fence and water the grass and keep people out. Keeping people out and sort of discouraging people from flowing through, this is starting to create little places for, people actually set up camps, but they'll be sort of out of sight, out of mind areas. And so the other reason, I think by doing this, we can plant this bed so that people who are concerned about children or others potentially running out of traffic, they're not going to run through the creek and run through a bank of low bushes and wild roses. And so the sight lines will be maintained, feel really open, but there won't be an actual enclosure. And the other safety thing, a lot of these comments, and notebooks have a history of this and have participated in the development design to a certain extent, but really extensive comments came back from various researchers, having a lot to do with maintenance and having a lot to do with the safety and sight lines. And they're really concerned that as much as you as a person looking straight out of the fence, it looks wide open and just basically transparent, just a bar. So when you're a car driving along, all you see are those bars, it might as well be a solid wall. And so when people pop out, they pop out out of the blue, out of nowhere. So that was a very big concern for people working with your street services. And they can be really kind of, some things are really tough, but there's just safety is their thing. And so once you understand that, I think all of that starts to make sense. So let's go to the plan. Oh, yeah, another big thing, the constraints on the site. Again, this isn't just a park out somewhere where you could paint by numbers and plant the landscape. This diagram I put here, these are locations where all these banks of utilities. There are 8-inch gas mains, 24, 27-inch water mains, multiple sewer lines, two different storm drain systems, and there are all of the slices of the site, and you can see me kind of like, what are the trees out and around them, because you can't literally get in here with large plant materials. You can do the concrete plaza area, this area of plant some trees where we sneak them in, but there's a lot of constraints. In addition to the traffic control 101, the design we're coming up with is working within all of these issues. So before, I think we're proposing mounds, those are difficult because of visibility. Some of the previous concepts didn't take that into consideration in some of these areas where you can't plant trees. But going to the next one. So this is, I'm trying to put labels in here. Stay after, and we more closely and discuss it on the board. But this is that idea of the dry sweet creek bed and feeding through here through trees, where the sidewalk goes around just like it would. And then this central area would be a concrete plaza with some trees sit in that. And you could take in the pattern of in the concrete, or maybe replace some small boulders for sitting. You could continue the idea of the brush you could just snake the site. And we'll look at some ideas of the arts program. But one thing that this concrete plaza area will provide us with the opportunity to do is something some of the folks mentioned last time, and that is the idea that there are numerous history and railroad history clubs, and there's I don't know how many historical photos that people have. And so the concrete plaza, we can photo etch those historical photos on tiles and place them in the concrete of the plaza. And then I'm not an artist, I'm an architect, I'm a landscape designer, but we would get an artist to help with that arts program of how it was replaced, what the selection is, if there's other interpretive information in there or not. And then the other thing I would recommend is you get the sight line into this closet area, then you will work standing cut steel panels to just welcome people to the area, point out what a special place it is. My first thought for that, but that's part of what I'm here to hear from you. My first thoughts for that would be, why not just have a simple abstracted landscape of hills with streams running through them and roses in the foreground, and no words, very simple. And people, if you already get this, it's supposed to represent stream, you would have that reinforced. So with that, I'd like to recommend and propose a local artist, Michael Messel, whom we've worked a lot in our streets over the years. And I want to show you, when we were looking at the first park, there was the deer figures and the grizzly bear. He does some work that is very simple. He does some other work in cut steel that's very complex. And he has a studio here in El Sereno and has worked in this area for a long time. These in particular were taking the work of Carla Gomez Garza. And she's a Guatemalan outdoor artist, so the cut paper, interpreting that in cut steel. Because with modern computer controlled cutting, you can get incredible amounts of detail. And let's just look at a few more of these images. This is another from the same piece we just looked at. And then this is a piece he did. And this is something similar to what I'm talking about, a large panel. In this case, it's deer, mountain lions, and grizzly bears, and some herons, and fish, and frogs, and water. The possibilities are really endless. But that's something that big gateway piece that you would see upon entering the community, and combined with whatever we do in the program of putting the historical tiles, the photos on tiles through the plaza, and whatever else we put in the plaza. And part of that, one thing's been beautiful for a long time, and I think putting the photo tiles in the concrete will provide a very minimal target for the meeting. I really want to see what you're writing. And the joyous thing with this work too, we've had this in public places for over 20 years, they're black paint and steel, so that they do the tag and it's difficult to black paint, and you're good to go. That's another example from right up the street of the local park. They're kind of taking this is just an individual house block. I think the one that I showed earlier is a better kind of comparison. What you might see when it's just planted In this case, we did a little bit of a suggestion to see that the St. Mark's, but then we go over and we shade and we need pleasant places to pass through. It's a really tough route when you're coming down Soto. You know, so little sidewalks, so much traffic, and this is going to be, at least for this part, I think, a huge transformation from the engineering project. It's going to give us those sidewalks, give us those curb cuts, so you don't have to let them how do you manage some of those, and that can't be easy. So that's it. If we can start with maybe sort of life and you know comments, questions before we stay around.
Okay, so you've seen, I think there's a couple parts that we wanted to talk about to get your input on.
First, like,
as Holly said, the plants, the actual plant palette, what we conceptualize here, we'd like to take your comments on, and then I'll see the art program. Yes. Well, I think that one of Holly's specialties, and she can speak for this herself, but what I've seen in helping with the development of parks and urban forestry in general, we're very aware of some of the challenges in a city and how people use land. And so you incorporate the design. You can encourage certain behavior or you can discourage other behavior. You can put a plant, strategically plant certain types of plants to keep people, you know, you want it to look beautiful, you want it to attract wildlife, you want it to, be pleasant, but it can also discourage things, which is one reason why you notice there's no turf. We absolutely think that turf is a bad idea in a medium like this. Turf has its place in parks for recreational purposes, but that would encourage people to come and want to stay and linger and maybe spend the night and maybe never leave. I'm sure, I don't know if I ever heard somebody speaking earlier about a little pocket park that was just recently built over at the intersection of Alameda and Main. And it's just nothing about, nothing but homeless people hanging out there, And so we want this is not a park. What we're designing here is a medium. We want people to be able to walk through it, to enjoy it, obviously drive past it. Maybe spend a little time taking in the artwork and knowing more about the history of the space, but it's not supposed to be a place where people spend the night or even have a picnic for that matter. So this is something that can be addressed through the design.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to talk about the visibility. Kind of security to design. You certainly need to put in not just designs that would be pleasant places to be in traffic. Really beautiful. And there's a kind of eyes on the street. The more kind of people that are looking in, the more people are passing through, the more kind of circulation of people going by and seeing all the way in the site. That's all about keeping what you're talking about in check. Because as soon as and we really feel like that's going to be a really big challenge here, and I go back to what I mentioned about the events, because these folks are actually necessary. Obviously, the department is going to be here in the fire aspect, but they have a huge potential here. This department has to be a little backlog where nobody goes, nobody sees. You know, where nobody goes, nobody sees. That's where your potential for people doing things that homesteading and all kinds of things. Really not
like to see in your neighborhood and
your front, your
living.
Naturally,
the
departments don't want those kind of activities on
their
front. So, I hope I.
Yeah,
I hope I have.
We also, I would say, visibility. for vehicular traffic, but also for, we've dealt with this over the years. For example, when I plant in public housing facilities, also known as the project, they're very concerned about police, the ability for police to be able to see in. So we incorporate that in the selection of our trees. For example, the California sycamore is a very fast growing. It's native, it would have been found there, so that also was the reason why we selected it. But I also know that a sycamore will grow very quickly, and so it's easy, you'll be able to see under it. It won't obscure these, like these lines of sight that Holly's talking about. People need to be able to see it.
And they also grow, they're a lot of light comes through them. They're the shade tree, but they're an open kind of shade. They don't create dark, dense, shady, hidden places. In the previous landscape design, sycamores were also incorporated, but the other two trees, we eliminated. And one of them was called California pepper, but it's really for the blue. And the reason that's a scrub tree, it's green and shiny and attractive, but its habit, what it wants to do is become a fountain of green all the way down. And that's the last thing you want to do, because each of those would be a hiding place behind it, and limit the ways of minion.
Could we consider some trees called liquid ambers that change colors during autumn? Beautiful golden red trees, and then they fall for the winter, so it shows a season.
The Bureau of Street Services won't plant liquid amber anymore. They're highly discouraged. It's not on the list of acceptable trees because they have huge potential for failure. They cause a lot of property damage when their limbs fail at a certain age. All over the city, they've destroyed cars and they could be a potential hazard to people. So that the liquid amber is